بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف المرسلين نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. We resume our lessons in Al-Adab Al-Mufrad by Imam Al-Bukhari. May Allah have mercy and be pleased with him. And today we start a new bab, a new chapter, where the author, Allah have mercy on him, talks about the birr, the respect that a Muslim has to have towards his father. Now last week we talked about how a Muslim should respect his mother. And just to repeat very briefly the status of a mother in Islam, we mentioned how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, وَوَصَّيْنَا الْإِنسَانَ بِوَالِدَيْهِ حُسْنًا. And in some ayat, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, talking about the mother. And in some ayat, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَوَصَّيْنَا الْإِنسَانَ بِوَالِدَيْهِ إِحْسَانًا حَمَلَتُ أُمُّ وَهْنًا عَلَى وَهْنٍ. And we mentioned that if you ponder over these two ayat that are in the Quran, you will see that there's three huge sacrifices that a mother makes. There's three huge sacrifices that a mother makes. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He didn't leave them hidden. He didn't leave them hidden. Everybody sees a father strive. Everybody sees him go to work early in the morning and endure the difficulties and sacrifice, come home late at night, leave early in the morning, come home and he's tired. Sometimes you see the sacrifice on his clothes, and it's the wisdom of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He didn't leave the rites, the sacrifices of a mother, He didn't leave them unseen. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, with His wisdom, He chose with His wisdom to give a mother more, He chose to make the mother more deserving of respect, to such an extent where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, ummak, 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 thumma abak, thumma al-aqrab fal-aqrab, in the hadith that we took last week. Now a mother makes many sacrifices. The first sacrifice that she makes is that she holds that baby. How Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, حَمَلَتُ وَهْنًا عَلَى وَهْنٍ حَمَلَتُ كُرْهًا وَوَضَعَتُ كُرْهًا. That a mother holds the baby in difficulty. The difficulties and the sacrifices that she has to make to hold this child, only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows the pain and the anxiety and the difficulties that she goes through. And today we're going to talk about one hadith where once Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu an, he was in the open area of the mosque in Mecca, Masjid al-Haram, and he saw a man carrying his mother doing tawaf, and his mother was on his back. So he came and he asked Abdullah ibn Umar, "Ara'aytani aturani jazaytuha?" He says, "Do you see that I have aturani jazaytuha? That do you see that I have fulfilled, or I have paid her back for the sacrifices that she has made for me?" And he told her that you haven't even paid her back to the equivalent of one breath that a mother takes when she delivered you. Not even one breath that your mother takes when she delivers that baby. So the first sacrifice that a mother makes is that a mother has to hold that child. And then you've got the sacrifice that a mother has to make whilst giving birth or giving birth to that child. How Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَضَعَتْهُ كُرْهَا. And only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows the difficulties and the sacrifices that the mother has to make in order to give birth to this child. And then how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَالْوَالِدَاتُ رُضِعْنَ أَوْلَادَهُنَّ حَوْلَيْنِ كَامِلَيْنِ لِمَنْ أَرَادَ أَنْ يُتِمَّ الرَّضَاعَةَ. That the last sacrifice that a mother makes is when she has to breastfeed that child. She can't eat whatever she wants to eat. She has to maintain a healthy lifestyle. All this to try and nurture that child, to try and bring that child up in a healthy way. And because of all this, Allahu A'lam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He made the mother more deserving of birr. Now we mentioned that birr is a comprehensive word that means all good. When you read birr in the Quran, it entails all good. And the biggest birr is tawheed, to believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and to believe in His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and to believe in His beautiful names and His perfect qualities. This is the biggest form of birr. And another example of birr is to pick up litter from the street. So when you read birr in the Quran, it entails all good. So today Imam al-Bukhari, in his third chapter of his book, Al-Adab al-Mufrad, after mentioning the rights of a mother, after mentioning two ahadith where he mentions the rights of a mother, now he mentions the rights of a father. And just like a mother, a father has rights. He's got right. He has a right to you respecting him, to you being kind to him, to you being easy for him, towards him. And there's one hadith on the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that's going to come in Adab al-Mufrad, but inshallah it will come in inshallah in the coming weeks. Where once a man went to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and asked to him that, how do I do birr to my father and he's passed away? My father has passed away and now he's in his grave. But is there any way, he's asking the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, is there any way that I can be good, I can do birr to my father, seeing as he's passed away? So the Prophet ﷺ encouraged or advised this questioner to do good, to be good to the friends of his father. To the friends of his father. Especially the friends of your father, especially your father's friends that are on istiqamah. The friends that your father had that are on the way of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, these are most deserving to you being kind to you respecting. So just like a mother, a father deserves your respect. He deserves you to be kind to. He deserves you to lower your voice. He deserves your assistance and your help. And in one hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, just like the previous hadith, he was asked, man abar? A companion, a sahabi, went to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and asked him, O Messenger of Allah, who's most deserving of my birr? Who's most deserving of my good? So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told him, your mother. And then he posed the question a second time. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam replied, just like how he replied before. And then he posed the question a third time. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he replied, just like how he replied before. And then he posed the question a fourth time. And the Prophet ﷺ this time gave him a different answer. He says, ثُمَّ أَبَاكَ. That after you respect your mother, and you respect her, and you respect her, now respect your father. Now respect your father. And then, after your father, then the Prophet ﷺ says, ثُمَّ الْأَقْرَبْ فَالْأَقْرَبْ. We mentioned last week in the hadith that after your father, then the people that are closest to you, like your mother's sister. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says in the hadith, al-khalatu bimanzilati al-umm. So your paternal aunt, your paternal aunt is closer to you after your mother. She has the affection and the devotion. She has the care and the love, just like a mother would have. She has the care and the feeling, just like a mother would have. The sister of your mom, the sister of your mother. So in this hadith, we see clearly the status of a father in Islam. And that just like a mother, he is respected. And he has a right to us being kind to, and to us helping him and assisting him. And then in another hadith, Imam al-Bukhari brings another hadith just has the same meaning as the first one. And inshallah, bi-idhnillah, we'll go to the next chapter. And in the next chapter, Imam al-Bukhari says, Bab birru walidayhi wa in zalama. Birru walidayhi wa in zalama. So Imam al-Bukhari now, when Imam al-Bukhari brings these chapters, these headings, a lot of scholars have mentioned, they were astounded at the understanding of Imam al-Bukhari to such an extent where he reads, he has an opinion over a certain issue, and he goes in his book and he composes a heading relating to that hukum, that ruling. So Imam al-Bukhari in the hadith that he's gonna compile, or he's gonna mention just after the heading, what's the ruling of a man when his parents do abuse to him? What's the ruling? What's the stance of so and so person? Does he have to do birr? Does he have to be kind to his parents once they abuse him? And before we go into this hadith, there's an ayah in the Quran where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَإِن جَاهَدَاكَ عَلَىٰ أَن تُشْرِكَ بِاللَّهِ مَا لَيْسَ لَكَ بِهِ عِلْمٌ فَلَا تُطِعْهُمَا وَصَاحِبْهُمَا فِي الدُّنْيَا مَعْرُوفًا. This ayah was revealed. One of the reasons for this ayah being revealed is one of the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he was upon the religion of the Quraysh. He was amongst the idol worshippers. And as we all know that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the first years of his da'wah, he used to do da'wah in secrecy. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave victory to Islam, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was allowed to openly call to Islam. So this particular companion, he embraced Islam, and he had a mother that was on the religion of the people of Mecca, the people of Shirk. So upon hearing this, this mother resorted to any way where she could try and stop him. Or she tried to look at any way where she could, where she could try and make him come out of the fold of Islam. So she told him that doesn't Islam call to being good to your parents and obeying them and listening to them and being obedient to them? So he said, yes, indeed. And if I'm not mistaken, I think this is Sa'ad ibn Abi Waqas radiallahu anhu, or Amr ibn al-As radiallahu anhu, one of the two. So his mother asked him, that doesn't the religion of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam have a status of a mother in Islam? You say that Islam calls to being good to your parents, speaking the truth, being good to your neighbors. I'm your mother, and I command you to leave the religion of Muhammad. So here is a mother, and she's asking her son, she's preventing her son from the goodness, from the guidance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the guidance of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. She's trying to use the status of Islam, the status that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave her. She's trying to use it in preventing her son from benefiting from the guidance of Islam. So it was after this incident that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed this ayah, that wa in jahadak, we're talking about how does a person have to do birr? Does a person have to be kind to his parents even though they abuse him? So if your parents ask you to do shirk, if your parents ask you to do shirk, which is set partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then you are not allowed to acknowledge their call. But how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, وَصَاحِبْهُمَا فِي الدُّنْيَا مَعْرُوفًا, be kind to them. Don't acknowledge their call. Don't abide. Don't obey their command. But at the same time, be kind to them. Be kind to them. Help them. Assist them. These are the rights of a parent in Islam. So if they ask you to do shirk, then as a Muslim, you are not allowed to listen to them. But you turn away, you turn away, you turn that request, okay? You turn away in that request politely and kindly. But if they abuse you, then you still have to be kind to them and you still have to do bid to them. You still have to be kind to them and you still have to be obedient to them. And Imam al-Bukhari now, this is the madhab of Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah. The rights of a parent, you can never take them away. Whatever wrong they do. Whatever wrong they do, the rights of a parent, you can never take, you can never take them away. Even if they abuse you. Even if they abuse you. There's a hadith on the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We're talking about parents, but there's a hadith in the Prophet ﷺ which is sahih, where he mentions the rights of a ruler. Authentic hadith, sahih, on the Prophet ﷺ, where he says, you listen and you obey even if he has to lash you and take your money. Even under these conditions, you obey your ruler. Even if he has to take your money and whip your back. If this is to a ruler, what's the respect of someone to their mother and their father? If this is the respect that someone has over their ruler, to such extent where the Prophet ﷺ says that if he has to take your money and if he has to whip your back, imagine the status, imagine the right of a mother if she has to abuse you. To such an extent where the Prophet ﷺ, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala answers the call of all dua except the dua where there is qati'atul rahim, where you ask for to sever ties. Allah accepts all du'as except the du'a where you ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to sever your ties. So the rights of a parent in Islam, even though they abuse you, those rights still stand. They're still there. You will be held responsible over them. When you die and you meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you will be held responsible over these rights, even if your parents abuse you. Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma qal, ma min muslimin lahu walidani musliman yusbihu ilayhima muhtasiban illa fataha Allah babayni, ya'ni min al-jannah. وإن كان واحدا فواحدا وإن أغضب أحدهما لم يرضى الله عنه حتى يرضى عنه قيل وإن ظلما قال وإن ظلما. First of all, this hadith, this is not a hadith in the Prophet ﷺ. This is an athar on Ibn Abbas رضي الله عنه. So this is not a statement of the Prophet ﷺ. This is a statement of one of the Salaf, of one of the companions of the Prophet ﷺ, of Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma. He was asked, he said, ma min muslim lahu walidan, that there's not a Muslim who has two parents, a mother and a father. Yusbihu ilayhima muhtasiba, every day he wakes up enduring the difficulties of bearing with parents, especially in old age. Sometimes parents can become unbearable. And this is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَلَا تَقُلْ لَهُمَا أُفٍ وَلَا تَنْهَرْهُمَا. Because sometimes you can be driven to that extent where you are driven to say uff. And sometimes you are driven to that extent where you have to tell them off. وَلَا تَنْهَرْهُمَا. And if you're driven to that extent, the Quran commands you not to do so. In fact, it commands you to do in contradiction of that. وَلَا تَنْهَرْهُمَا وَاخْفِضْ لَهُمَا جَنَاحَ الظُّلْ وَقُلْ لَهُمَا قَوْلًا كَرِيمًا. That say to them a statement of generosity, a statement of kindness and good, and be lenient to them. When they make requests and these requests are repeated and you get agitated, you get upset, فَلَا تَنْهَرْهُمَا, that do not shout at them, do not stop them, do not speak to them in a harsh way. And before that he says, فَلَا تَقُلْ لَهُمَا أُفْ, that do not say uff, do not utter a statement where people can see, or it can be shown that you're upset and you're agitated and now you're overcome with grief and you're upset. So yusbihu ilayhima muhtasiba illa fataha Allahu lahu illa fataha Allahu babayni ya'ni min al-jannah. So he wakes up every day with his parents, he does ihtisab, endures the difficulties of bearing with his parents, except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala opens two doors of Jannah. Wa in kana wahidan fa wahida, and if he wakes up to one parent, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala opens one door for him. Wa in aghdaba ahadahuma lam yarda Allahu anhu hatta yarda an, and if he upsets them, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will be upset over him or with him, provided his parents are upset over him. And if they are happy with him, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will be happy with him, provided his parents are happy with him. And then it was asked to Ibn Abbas, he was asked, wa in dhalama, is this the case even if the parents abuse him? Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma, he says, wa in dhalama, that even if parents abuse him, this is the case. Sheikh Albani, May Allah be pleased, may Allah have mercy on him. This athar with this wording is not authentic on Ibn Abbas. But some of the meanings in this hadith, some of the meanings in this athar, okay, they can be testified, they can be strengthened with other ahadith of the Prophet ﷺ. Some of the statements in this athar, they can be strengthened, they can be testified, they can be strengthened with other ahadith of the Prophet ﷺ. Because the fact that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is upset over you because of your parents, provided your parents are upset over you, this is authentic on the Prophet ﷺ. And what strengthened this part of this athar is the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ one day commanded someone, one of the companions, when he came for jihad, the Prophet ﷺ asked him, are your parents alive? So he says, yes. So he says, كَيْفَ تَرَكْتَهُمَا? How did you leave them? So he says, I left them crying. So the Prophet ﷺ says, go back and make them smile, just like how you left them crying. Go back and make them smile, make them happy, just like how you left them crying. And this is jihad. One of the most closest deeds to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we all know the status of a martyr in Islam, a shaheed. And the Prophet ﷺ tells a companion that, do you have parents? He says, yes. So the Prophet ﷺ tells him, go back and make them smile, make them happy, just like how you left them crying. And the Prophet ﷺ says in a hadith which is authentic, where the Prophet ﷺ says, سَخَطُ الرَّبِّ فِي سَخَطِ الْوَالِدِ رِضَ الرَّبِّ فِي رِضَ الْوَالِدِ. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is happy with you, provided your parents are happy with you. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, His anger is over you, provided your parents' anger is over you. So that part, this part of the athar, this statement of the athar, it can be strengthened in other ahadith of the Prophet ﷺ. But in a whole, the wording, the chapter, the heading that Imam al-Bukhari uses, where do I have to, as a Muslim, do I have to be good to my parents even though they abuse me? The answer is yes, you have to be good to them. You have to be good to them even if they abuse you. Because nothing can take away the rights of a parent. Nothing. Nothing can take away the rights of a parent. To such an extent, and I say this just to understand the parents, the rights of a parent in Islam. Allahu alam, I remember reading once a ruling on some of the fuqaha, where they say that if a father kills his son, he cannot be killed. To this extent, we're not looking at the ikhtilaf or the difference of opinion in the ruling, whether what should happen. But this is the status of parents in Islam. And they say because the parents are the reason for this person to exist after Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the heading that Imam al-Bukhari uses, what's the stance of a Muslim when he's abused by his parents? Should he be kind to them? Should he do birr? The answer is yes. Should he be kind to them? The answer is yes. And also in the time of the Prophet ﷺ, some of the sahabiyat, they would come to the Prophet ﷺ, and they would ask the Prophet ﷺ that my mother has come. Her mother has come and she's on the region of shirk. Should I keep my ties with her? Should I visit her? So the Prophet ﷺ says, yes, visit her. These are the rights of a parent. Then Imam al-Bukhari, we start a new chapter where Imam al-Bukhari says, Bab Linul Kalami Liwaliday. Linul Kalam Liwaliday. How should a person, Imam al-Bukhari says, how should a person speak to his parents? Because now we learnt respecting them. But what's the stance of a Muslim when he speaks to his parents? How should he speak to them? So Imam al-Bukhari comes with a chapter, a heading. Okay, he composes a heading where he says, Leenul Kalam. Lean in Arabic means something which is pleasant, something which is soft. And this is why the Prophet ﷺ, he says in the hadith, one day Aisha, As-Siddiqa bint As-Siddiq, radhiallahu anha, one of the Jews, they made a dua. They said, As-Salamu alaykum, or As-Salamu alaykum. They prayed on the Prophet ﷺ. So Aisha retaliated. And the Prophet ﷺ, ما دخل, and the Prophet ﷺ says that there's nothing, softness and kindness, there's nothing that softness and kindness is put into except it beautifies it. And there's nothing where you add aggressiveness and harshness to it except it corrupts it and it makes it not beautiful, not pleasant to look at. So leenul kalam li waliday. What's the stance of a Muslim? How should he speak to his mother or father? There's a haddathani طيسلة بن مياس قال كنت مع النجدات فأصبت ذنوبا طيسلة بن مياس he says كنت مع النجدات. نجدات is one of the sects of the Khawarij. Now the Khawarij, they have the Khawarij of the opinion, the extremists. They are not on the Sunnah of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. These are people that have chosen the hard way in Islam. And they are not from the Prophet ﷺ. They are not from the followers of the Prophet ﷺ. They are very aggressive and they are amongst the deviant people. They are amongst the deviant sects. And Allah and the Prophet ﷺ are innocent from these people. Because they like to do takfir. They like to take people out of the fold of Islam. They take people out of the fold of Islam by calling them kuffar. And then they call them kuffar and then they kill them. So they make halal their blood, their wealth and their families. So Taylasa bin Mayyas says, Kuntum an Najdat, one of the sects of the Khawarij. So he says, فَأَصَبْتُ ذُنُوبًا لَا أَرَاهَا إِلَّا مِنَ الْكَبَائِرِ. That I used to commit sins. And I wouldn't see these sins except they are the major sins. فَذَكَرْتُ ذَلِكَ لِبْنِ عُمَرِ. Here we see the guidance of the companions. And this is something that we need to try and implement and bring into our lives. How Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَاسْأَلُوا أَهْلَ الذِّكْرِ إِن كُنْتُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. So this person spent some time with the deviant people. And he was a victim of this deviance and this wrong. And this is what happens when you associate yourself and you mix yourself with people of wrong. That wrong influences you. And then it becomes a part of you. So he says, فَذَكَرْتُ ذَلِكَ لِبْنِ عُمَرِ. So he mentioned these issues to Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu an. So he says, Mahi, what are these issues? So he says, so and so. So Abdullah ibn Umar, he says, this is not, these sins that you mention, they are not amongst the major sins. And now Abdullah ibn Umar, he mentions the major sins. And these are sins that we as Muslims, we need to stay away from. Because sometimes, because we become so distant from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the way of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, sometimes you can fall into these traps. And sometimes you can commit these sins not thinking that they are the major sins. So the first one is, so Abdullah ibn Umar, he says, Laysat hiya min al-kaba'ir. That this sin, that these sins that you mentioned, they are not from the major sins. The major sins are nine. And then he mentions them, one after the other. So he says, Al-ishraku billah. This is the first sin. Shirk is the biggest sin. The biggest sin that a person can commit. To such an extent, because of shirk, the skies were going to crack. How Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, تَكَادُ السَّمَاوَاتُ يَتَفَطَّرْنَ أَنْ دَعُوا لِلَّهِ وَلَدًا. Because of this claim that they made that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has taken a son, it was going to split the sky. And how Luqman told his son, إِنَّ الشِّرْكَ لَظُلْمٌ عَظِيمٌ. It's a huge form of dhulm. You worship Allah, you worship someone or something despite acknowledging that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created you and that thing that you worship. And then the second major sin is al-firaru min al-zahf. When a Muslim has to turn away his back in jihad, when a Muslim has to turn away and run away in jihad, when Muslims are fighting the non-Muslims, and you surrender, because behind you surrendering comes the fall of the Muslim army. And when the Muslim army falls, difficulties come to all the Muslims of that city. Women, Muslim women are taken as slaves. Muslim children, families are broken and destroyed. And the religion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is marked. And the spreading of the Quran and the Sunnah is interrupted. And then waklu riba, to eat from means of interest. How Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَأَذَنُوا بِحَرْبٍ مِّنَ اللَّهِ. If you eat interest, you eat from profits that are earned through interest. وَأَكْلُ مَالَ الْيَتِيمِ. To eat the right of an orphan. How Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, إِنَّمَا يَأْكُلُونَ فِي بُطُونِهِمْ نَارًا. To eat Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with his wisdom. He makes a child, a yatim, by taking away their parent, by taking away his parents. And he leaves this yatim. He leaves him some money. And the person that comes to take care of him eats from this money. So that when he grows up, he's weak socially and financially. He's weak socially because, generally speaking, sometimes orphans, they've lost their parents. And sometimes they don't have good upbringings. No one was there to give them care and affection that they needed to grow up in a challenging world that we live in today. They've been denied this privilege with the wisdom of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then add on to that, whatever the parents left for them is taken away in abuse. وَإِلْحَادٌ فِي الْمَسْجِدِ To mark the religion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the mosque. And then Abdullah ibn Umar says, وَالَّذِي يَسْتَسْخِرْ وَبُكَاءُ الْوَالِدَيْنِ مِنَ الْعُقُوقِ To leave your parents crying because you are not kind to them. And then Abdullah ibn Umar gives advice to this person. He says, أَتَفْرَقُ النَّارِ Are you afraid of the fire of Jahannam? وَتُحِبُّ أَن تَدْخُلَ الْجَنَّةِ And would you love to go to Jannah? So he says, Ey wallah. Wallahi, I'd love this. So he says, أَحَيٌّ وَالِدَاكُ Are your parents alive? So the questioner, he says, عِنْدِي أُمِّي I have my mother, she's alive. So Abdullah ibn Umar says, فَوَاللَّهِ لَوْ أَلَنْتَ لَهَا الْكَلَامِ If you had to speak to her in a tone which is kind and soft, وَأَطْعَمْتَهَا الطَّعَامِ And you have to feed her, لَتَدْخُلَنَّ الْجَنَّةَ مَجْتَنَبْتَ الْكَبَائِرِ If you have to speak to her in a way that's soft and kind, and you have to feed her, Wallahi, he emphasizes this with lam, lam al-ta'keed, lam al-tawkeed, and noon, noon al-tawkeed also. لَتَدْخُلَنَّ الْجَنَّةَ مَجْتَنَبْتَ الْكَبَائِرِ That you will, indeed, verily you will go to Jannah, provided you stay away from the major sins. حدثنا أبو نعيم قال حدثنا سفيان عن هشام ابن عروة عن أبيه قال واخفض لهما جناح الذل من الرحمة قال لا تمتنع من شيء أحبا هشام ابن عروة on his father he says واخفض لهما جناح الذل من الرحمة the father of هشام ابن عروة عروة he's doing tafsir of واخفض the statement of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala where he says وَخْفِضْ لَهُمَا جَنَاحَ الظُّلِّ مِنَ الرَّحْمَةِ He says, this ayah means, do not stay away from anything that they like. Lowering your wing of being easy to your parents is you not refraining from anything in you, not staying away from anything that they like. So basically, whatever they like, provided it's not shirk, it's not haram, do it for them. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to guide us and to make it easy for us and to make us the people, to make us amongst the people that hear good and propagate it and spread it. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us amongst the people that respect and are kind to their parents. إِنَّهُ وَلِيُّ ذَلِكَ وَالْقَادِرُ عَلَيْهِ وَصَلَّى اللَّهُ وَسَلَّمْ وبارك على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين